The psalmist gives us a wonderful promise. I waited patiently for the Lord. He turned to me and heard my cry. He lifted me out of the slimy pit and out of the mud and the mire. He set my feet on a rock and gave me a firm place to stand. He put a new song in my mouth and a hymn of praise to our God. Many will see and fear the Lord and put their trust in Him. Blessed is the one who trusts in the Lord, who does not look to the proud, to those who turn aside to false gods. Many, Lord my God, are the wonders you have done, the things you have planned for us. None can compare with you. What I to speak and tell of your deeds, they would be too many to declare. Then I said, here I am. I have come, and it is written about me in the scroll. I desire to do the will. My God, your law is within my heart. Will you pray with me? Our Father in heaven, as we bow before you this morning, and the choir has so wonderfully proclaimed such love, Lord. Now, our Father, we just pray that you would just move in our midst, Lord, and forgive us, Lord, where we have sinned and fallen short. But Lord, may the name of Jesus be on our hearts to glorify and worship you. In Christ's holy and wonderful name of Jesus, we pray. Amen and amen. And once more, I bring greetings to each and every one this morning in the name of Jesus. Sister Nan had an announcement.
The Nurture Commission is coming up with a list of ushers. And if you would like your name on the list, please see Kathy or me. And we'll make sure you get on the list and get a job.
Yeah, it is wonderful to have someone to greet us on. You don't have to worry about that when you get to heaven. There'll be a greeter waiting on you. And his name is Jesus. So, have others this morning? And this is, of course, everyone knows, you know, and not all, but you hear so much about traveling. But that's a journey. I can't wait. But because of number 6 and number 7 daughters, I'm going to do everything humanly possible to stay here as long as I can. She's grinning and crying at the same time back there. But take your hymn books. And today's message, I've been working on it for a long time. But titled simply, What's in Your Hand? And I can't wait to get there. So this America the Beautiful, if my memory holds me correct, was finished on Pike's Peak in Colorado Springs, Colorado. It was finished coming back down from the peak. And I've only seen it 2 or 3 times. But America is beautiful. But America still needs prayer. So this morning, as we look to Psalms 33:12, blessed is the nation whose God is the Lord. So let us stand on this Sunday of worship, America the Beautiful. Sister Julie.
Thank you.
Amen. You may be seated. And as we come before our Father in a prayer of a body in Christ, do we have praises before we bow unto Him together? Sister Arlene.
Our cousin Donna Campbell has started her radiation. As far as she knows now, that goes until August the 9th. She wants to thank everybody for your prayers. She said she could feel the prayers being answered. And also, my great-granddaughter Katie has been diagnosed with Lyme disease.
Wow.
Yes, you pray for her.
Amen. We will. Others?
Excuse me. What kind of disease?
Lyme.
Lyme.
Yes.
I give a little update on Karen. She's with a new doctor now. They finally read her x-rays after 3 months. The doctor said that inflammation shows up as a little white area on the x-rays. She said that mom's hip looks like a whiteout. So she can hardly walk, but she's due to get an injection in her hip in 3 weeks. I don't know why they waited so long.
Okay.
It'll be 3 weeks, and she has to go back for another 1 week later. So just keep her in her prayers.
We will. Thanks, brother. Okay. Others? Yes, sister.
Just have a great big praise for our prayer meeting on Monday at Kathy and Paul's. And if you weren't there, you missed it.
Yeah. Thank you. Unspoken requests, unspoken praises within your hearts. Lord, we so humbly bow before You in the name of Your Son, Jesus. And Lord, a wise man once penned that as soon as he starts praying, his mind begins to wander. We too, Lord, we wonder so much. But Lord, this morning, I just want to bow before You and just look into Your holiness through the name of Jesus, Lord, and just give You the glory for where we have been. Lord, we've been through many trials, and yet there You are, holding firmly and holding us, Lord, in the hollow of Your hand as one day You covered Moses. So, Lord, this morning we want to thank You for each one that is here and each one that lifted up a friend that's Donna, that's gone through trials within her life. Katie and Karen, Lord, they're more, Lord, than just names upon our lips, Lord. They are loved ones of yours and servants of a living God. So thank you, our Father, for each hand that was lifted up. And Lord, as we look to America, Lord, all the land is beautiful, but oh, Father, there's so much hurt going on. And we just see just a shadow, Lord, of what you see. And yet, Lord, you never forsake us. So we pray for America today, Lord. We pray for our leaders that are standing firm where the Word of God and this nation stand together. And others, Lord, who are leading us away from your truth, pray a conviction upon their hearts. And Lord, may we as a body not become angry, but Lord, may we just become prayer warriors for this nation, for our homes, Lord. We might show other nations, as your people Israel was called to show, that Jehovah is their God. May we likewise, Lord, continue that challenge and not become weary. So, Lord, thank you for the freedom just to pray in this place. In Christ's holy name, amen and amen. Someone have an offertorial thought. Well, the Lord gave me one through the help of Chris this morning, and I don't know how long I've been standing, but I'm over it. I said, do you know what you said? Nope. And I don't want to say it's hard week after week after week to not mess up. But I am who I am, and you accepted me as that. And so I thank you. So I asked Chris this morning, how are you? And he said, I'm good. He said, I have everything. And my mind went click. Now I have everything. How many of you know that song? Ah, come on. Nobody? You're about to hear it. I asked Sissy. Sissy, print me. Now I have everything. I look in the book and it's not there. And I'm not afraid of making a fool of myself.
I had nothing but heartaches and troubles. I was seeking for fortune and fame. I had nothing but doubts and confusion, but now I have everything. I have everything I need to make me happy. I have Jesus to show me the way. Show me the way for
Let us stand together. And our Father, we do praise you now, Lord. And Father, what an opportunity just to praise you in our giving. Receive now, our Father, is our prayer in your Son's name. Amen. You may be seated. As we look to the word of a living God, I pray now that each one might take out your Bibles and turn with me to two scriptures. I want to turn first of all to John, a familiar passage to each and every one. In fact, it's recorded in all the Gospels, but John's the only one that brings the boy up. Listen or follow along, but hear the message that John is recording for us. Jesus had just got the news that John the Baptist had been murdered. And he was wanting to rest. That's what Jesus wanted to do. That's the reason he went up on the mountain. He went up on there with his disciples to teach and to rest. And then here's what happened on the mountain. When Jesus looked up and saw a great crowd coming to him, he said to Philip, "Where should we buy bread for these people to eat?" He asked this only to test him, for he already had in mind what he was going to do. Philip answered him, "It would take more than a half a year's wages to buy enough bread for each one to have a bite." Another of his disciples, Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, spoke up. "Here is a boy with five small barley loaves and two small fish. But how far will they go among so many?" Jesus said, "Have the people sit down. There's plenty of grass in that place," and they sat down. About 5,000 men were there. Jesus took the loaves and gave thanks and distributed them to those who were seated, as much as they wanted. He did the same with the fish. When they had all had enough to eat, he said to his disciples, "Gather the pieces that are left over. Let nothing be wasted." So they gathered them and filled 12 baskets with the pieces of five barley loaves left over by those who had eaten. And then if we'll turn to the book of Exodus, and here probably most of us, or not all of us, know the story. Moses had murdered an Egyptian. He went to hide. And then the Lord is calling him back to bring his people out of Egypt. Hence the word Exodus. And as we start with Exodus 4, just verses 2 to 6 in Exodus 4. Let's just back up to one. God's asking him a question. And Moses answered, "What if they do not believe me or listen to me and say, 'The Lord did not appear to you'?" Then the Lord said unto him, "What is that in your hand?" "A staff," he replied. The Lord said, "Throw it on the ground." Moses threw it on the ground, and it became a snake, and he ran from it. Then the Lord said to him, "Reach out your hand and take it by the tail." So Moses reached out and took hold of the snake, and it turned back into a staff in his hand. "This," said the Lord, "is so that they may believe that the Lord, the God of their fathers, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob, has appeared unto you." Will you pray with me? Our Father in heaven, once more, Lord, we thank you for your written word. But Lord, we thank you for your truth. May the Holy Spirit now, Lord, just indwell anew in our hearts this morning. May the words spoken, Lord, be your words and your truth. And may I now, Lord, weak that I am, bring your truth unto your people. In Christ's holy name I pray. Amen. So as we look to the Word of God this Independence weekend, I have two true, I guess for lack of a better word, stories, true stories. And I found them in Jeffrey Blake's book, or author Jeffrey Blake, It's Not What You Think. And the introduction page was penned for him by Ann Westkeep. Listen to what she says. And keep in your mind the title of today's message, "What's That in Your Hand?" as God asked Moses. So the first story is something that many dream about. I've worked construction for about, I don't know, give or take 50 years. Tore a whole lot of houses down and moved a whole lot of stuff in old houses all over this local mountains. And I've yet to find anything of value. Sissy found a 1818 silver dollar, and it came from the altar of all places in a Catholic church from Cumberland, Maryland. In fact, the top half is back here in the nursery, and we was cutting a hole for a sink. Vagabond in Oakland on Alder Street purchased it, and we refurnished it for the coffee stand. If you go in there, right there it is. Right when you walk in, there is the Catholic altar. And she found an 1818 silver dollar just fell out of the air. Listen to this. Keep in mind what's in your hand. "Straight up," Ann says, "the guy just liked the frame. $4. That's all he had to dig out of his wallet at a flea market in Adamstown, Pennsylvania, in the morning of 1989 to buy one old, odd picture frame. He handed over the $4 and frankly didn't care one wimp about the painting. A dismal little country setting dabbed across a grimy, torn canvas with a signature he couldn't even make out. You see, he was glued to the frame. That's what caught his eye. The flea market seller took his $4 with absolutely no idea what was in her hand when she handed the frame. The faintest idea of the frame or the paintings, they was not what you think. When the guy got home, the crudely maimed, pathetic frame fell apart in his hand. unsalvageable, he said. Great. $4, right down the drain. But when the unsalvageable frame, he began to pick it up, to discard of it, it fell apart more in his hand, away from the torn canvas. And there between the sliced canvas and the wood backing of a crumbled up frame was a crisp, folded up piece of paper about the size of a business envelope. He unfolded it slowly and ran his fingers across the ink and began to whisper, "Wow, could it be?" He called a friend who was an historical buff, and the friend came over, and his jaw dropped as he took that crumbled up frame, and again he showed him that piece of paper unfolded again ever so slowly and gently. He began to laugh, and then he said with a whisper, "Wow, could it be?" His next words was, "Get it appraised." That folded up piece of paper, a tenth of an inch thick, that had fallen out between a torn canvas and a falling away frame, was printed by John Dunlap on July 4th, 1776. Turns out it was one of only 500 copies of the first printing of the Declaration of Independence. The copy was auctioned off on June the 4th, 1991. And when the gavel finally sounded sold, and the auctioneer handed the paper to its new owner, the $4 flea market frame became a $2.4 million find of the new owner. And that is not the only time it happened. One more. Stan Clough, a pipe fitter, bought a copy, what he knew was a Declaration of Independence, at a yard sale, Dawson Hills, in 1996. He took it home and nailed it to the wall of his garage, for he thought it was a dime a dozen copy. But yet, not everything is as it seems. The piece of faded paper was there hanging on his garage with four nails for 10 years when Stan fixed a steady stream of motorcycles and bikes. Till finally Stan's wife, Linda, said, "It's time, Stan, clean up your garage." He said, "I admit, I'm a pack rat." And the best, he says, "I can recall, we had a little debate whether to keep that nailed up declaration or take it away. His wife won. He took it down." So Linda took an antique table, a shower massage, a faucet, and other everyday items, and she took it to a thrift store in Nashville, Tennessee, on the morning of March, when Michael Sparks ended up browsing and stumbling upon this yellowed piece of paper. $2.48 was all he had to pay to shell out for a worn document, which turned out to be one of only 200 official copies of the Declaration of Independence that had been commissioned by John Quincy Adams in 1820. Turns out he sold it at an auction sometime later, $477,650. When Stan heard, all he could say, "I didn't know what was in my hands." But he said, "I can't help to think I sure ain't very smart." You see, you can hold in your hand something that is valuable enough, and it can change everything about your life. You might think you know what's in your hands, but as it turns out, we and I really don't know it all. You think Jesus is just Jesus until you have nothing, and then Jesus is your everything. When you become God's, everything in your hand becomes His. It's like having an exorbitant, valuable declaration of freedom. How many of us can say when we hold within our hands, this is a declaration of freedom that God has given unto me? Many times in life, many Christians think that Christianity is just something about when I die, I get to go to heaven. And they fail to recognize that everyday freedom that the Word of God brings to each and every one of us. Sometimes in our life, there's a breathtaking moment that kind of holds us in a spell just for a moment. Don't miss your life-changing value of the declaration of freedom in God's Word. You see, many times in life, we can't afford, because we move on from where God had placed us. 1 Chronicles 16:27 says, glory and honor are in His presence when the gladness of obedience is in His heart. Hudson Taylor said once that he thought God was looking for men strong enough to be used by Him. And it didn't take long until he learned that God is looking for men, women, and children weak enough for Him to use. Many times, we don't know what we have. You know, we can put a cliche here and there that you don't appreciate the water until you don't have any. How many times I've got a phone call, said, Donnie, whatever, just fill in the blank. And I mean, it's a long list. Jesus took bread that day and He broke it. Every time we allow Jesus to break us from our pride, break us from our anger, and we begin to pass it around. Each time we hold in our hands something so valuable, and we think it's just a crumbled up piece of nothing. It was Andrew who brought that little boy to Jesus. And by bringing him and it to Jesus, he made a miracle possible. As I was going over this lesson, and I have several commentaries, and one egghead said, and I'm going to quote it word for word, but he said the reason they had so much food that there was some 20,000 people coming, and they traveled 7 miles. And most of them probably took food with them. This is egghead author. And he said, but when they seen the boy giving up his 5 barley loaves, and barley loaves is the cheapest of bread. It's like day-old bread at a fresh bread store. It's worthless. Said that the people's hearts was moving, and they began to distribute their food. There ain't no truth in that. He had in his hand. What if, just for a moment, what if you can picture him when he left home that day? Doesn't say nothing about his father or mother or relatives, but somebody was with him. What if they said, son, do you know you're holding in your hand today's dinner for some 20,000 men, women, and children? I don't think you can convince him of that. But yet he gave. He is the widow lady in the temple. He gave his all from what's in his hand. Andrew didn't know what he was doing when he brought the boy to Jesus. But he was providing the means for a miracle for Jesus to work. Many times we hold in our hands a miracle for Jesus to work. And we're like Moses. Who am I, Lord, that you're sending me? Who am I that I am to go before the king and say, let my people go? You see, God has a desire for you and me to let go what's in your hand. It is a declaration of freedom. Not freedom as the world gives. Back to Darlene Rose's evidence not seen. You've heard that story and you're going to keep hearing it. And she found it in that little 6x6 cell the next morning. And she got on her knees and she said, I just wept. He was here and I knew it not. Like Jacob, a stone for a pillow. And records the Lord was in this place. I had him in my hands. And knew it not. Jesus needs what we bring into him. May not be much, but he needs it. Oh, the world will say, that's no miracle. The world will say, there's no triumph and beauty in that. It's just a crumbled up old man waiting to die. And God says, it's a miracle waiting to happen. What if we would lay ourselves on that altar? What if we would be like Gideon, outnumbered 1,000 to 1? And God said, there's still too many. You'll get boastful and proud. You see, you don't have to be sorry. Sorry, Lord, this is all I have to bring. Don't do it! I'm glad, Lord, this is all I have to bring. Don't be embarrassed of loving Jesus. We keep saying to ourselves, there's got to be more. And I'm telling you, there is more. Remember the song that we sing occasionally, Little Is Much, when God is in it? When we train up our children in the ways of God, you have no idea where that's going to lead. None. My ministry started probably in 11th grade at Northern High School. For whatever reason, I had to take a drama class. I was the only boy in the class. And the teacher was a Tasmanian devil. That's where I learned to speak. That's where I learned to make sure my tie was straight. At that time, I wore an FFA jacket. Make sure it zipped all the way up. Flip the zipper down and tuck it in. Look them in the eyes. Talk slow. And we had to give a speech, like a 5-minute speech, and I was scared to death. And God was preparing a little farm boy in 1969 for this moment. And I knew it not. An old German school teacher once had, every morning he walked into his class and he would bow reverently to the class, stand up, God bless you. And one of the other teachers said, what are you doing? He was asked, he said, someday, you never know, one of these boys might be a great man for his country. That's why I do it. I don't know what's ahead of these boys. But I am bowing in reverence in the faith of Jesus. Unbeknown by him, he was right. One of the boys in his class was Martin Luther. Would split the Catholic Church. And we are here because of it. I challenge you. I challenge myself. What's in your hand that we can lay before God? Didn't he ask Jesus the same thing? Unless I see the nail prints in his hand and the mark in his side, I will not believe. And you know what Jesus said? Blessed are those who see my hands and believe. But more blessed are those who don't see and yet believe. Wow. Jesus found the material to do a miracle. And he'll find it in you. Oh, you might not see it, might not hear it, as Darlene Rose just prayed. One little story, then I'll close. Years ago, I was a hospice volunteer. And my first one was an elderly man who was a custodian at Southern High School. And he had bone cancer, and I spent many, many hours with him. And he knew I was just a very young, inexperienced, shy pastor at that time. And he began to talk about suicide. And he would belittle the ones that had taken their own life. Some of it was pretty raw. The last day of his life, I had opportunity, and they called me in. And it was in the hospital at Garrett County Memorial at that time. And for probably 8 to 10 hours before he drifted away into to sleep before death, all he said was, forgive me, God. Forgive me, God. Forgive me, God. Forgive me, God. He said, I still don't believe in it, but now I know why. This will change your life. No longer will you be a slave to the world. You'll be a slave to Jesus. What a compliment. This world don't have a clue what a slave is. But you do. You know when you hold within your hand the declaration of freedom. Pass it to Jesus. You never know. Let us pray. Our Father in heaven, Lord, we pause this morning and give our thanks as we hold within our hands, Lord, your truth and your word. And Lord, may we as a body and we as individuals, Lord, hold it lightly. That one ask by that still small voice, we can hand it to you. Use for your glory and your honor. Amen. I played drums for 9 years going through school. I played snare first, and then they moved me to the bass simply because I was tall. And I remember my drum instructor in third grade. She would walk through the class, and it was pathetic. I mean, it was like really bad. And occasionally, she would come back where we was playing. She would reach down and pull the sticks out of our hands. And then she would say, "You're holding it too tight. Hold it loosely so you can feel it. If you hold it tight, you'll not feel it." My dad told me that 1,000 times when he was teaching me how to run a dozer. He said, "Can't you feel it? Can't you hear it? Hear that engine working?" And after a while, I could tell how much was in my blade, where the rock was in the blade, how much I was pushing, all by feel. Just the touch and the sound of the engine. Jesus the Christ is the same way. I used to be pretty against feeling. Boy, did I make a 180. When the Holy Spirit moves within us, hold it lightly so he can move at will. Word of God, declaration of freedom. Let us stand. Hymn number 243.
Thank you.
And now, as our young acolytes, once more, bring into us not the closing of God's word, but as Jesus said on the cross, it is finished. His life on earth, he said, you have all you need. Just come to me. Let us pray. And now, our Father, once more, to the Most High God, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, the God of Jacob, the God whose only begotten Son is Jesus, the Christ, our risen Savior. Watch over thee and me till we meet again. In Christ's holy name we pray. Amen.
Oh Lord, please make me a sanctuary.
You all.